You are welcome to the broadcast of the Living Word of Faith Outreach Ministries International. In this broadcast, join International Crusade and Conference Speaker, Teacher, Senior Pastor, Apostle, General Overseer and Presiding Prelate of the Living Word of Faith Outreach Ministries International, Bishop Akintayo Samjoli.
I announce to you, whatever was to follow you, that is not from God, it will not follow you, it will not follow your children.
His teachings and ministries have brought deliverance and transformation to many lives and families across the nation and beyond. Receive God's word with faith in your heart and watch your life move from glory to glory.
Hallelujah. You're welcome this morning to another precious, powerful time in the presence of God, and I trust God that your life will never remain the same. And today we are going to look further into the scripture main that was read for this morning. And I want to encourage you and remind you that these scripture mains are powerful series, and all what it takes for you to get into the wealth of it is for you to meditate on it carefully and pay attention to it on a daily basis. Now, take note that when I speak of the scripture mean, I am not referring to the service going on, this devotional dawn service going on, but I'm referring to the daily studies that I sent out. And I want you to go through them, and then bless you. It's amazing to see the testimonies that are coming from ministers and ministries who take advantage of it and enter into blessings that they contain for God's people. Amen. And so, in yesterday's scripture, I mean, we looked at two priestly and kingdom responsibilities. These are responsibilities that belong to those in the kingdom of God, and those that serve God, and those that are called to ministry, and to every Christian. And so we want to read from the book of 1 Samuel chapter 12 again, and verses 23. It says, "Moreover, as for me, God forbid that I should sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray for you, but I will teach you the good and the right way." Now, so to have an understanding of what was going on here is that Israel had come to Samuel the priest and had told him that they do not want his sons to be kings over them anymore. And so Samuel was displeased. He took it to God, and God told him, give them what they've asked for. They asked for a king. They want their own king. And many things had gone on, and Israel had turned their backs on God. They were not living as God wanted them to live. Many things had happened around the life of Samuel. And so his whole life, his children were a disappointment to him. The nation were a disappointment to him. And all of these things happened around the life of Samuel. Now, and at this time, the Philistines had come against Israel. And so they came to Samuel to pray for them. And Samuel, in calling them to repentance, when they came for prayer, you know, it is very similar to what happens to people today. They live a life of rebellion, and then they know where the pastor is when they are in need. They know where the numbers are when they are in need. And that's when they come for prayer, when things have gone tough for them. As far as they're concerned, the pastor and his message are of little relevance. To one of the prophets, God took him to go and show him the people that he was praying for, the people that he was preaching, how they were saying that his words are like music to the air. They go and sit down and they listen, and they have already made up their mind. We will not do what he says. And but Samuel, in the midst of bringing the people to correction, he makes a very strong statement as to why he would gone to pray for them. And so here he says that the Lord forbid that he should cease to pray for them and to teach them the good and the right way. So in the midst of all the rebellion and all the wickedness, in the midst of all the disappointment that Samuel had, Samuel refused to do two things. He refused to stop praying for the people, and he refused to stop teaching them the good and the right way. You know, in ministry, there are times when people have treated us in a certain way. It is but natural for us to just withdraw from our duties that God requires of us. It is natural for us to give up on the things that God expects of us to do, to treat them in the kind of nonchalant way, all right, in which we are no longer seeking God on their behalf. We're no longer praying for them. And rather, if not careful, we actually go the other way around. We're praying against them, you know, and because of the things they've done wrong. But here Samuel says, God forbid that I should cease praying for you, all right, that I should sin against the Lord. So it's not just to stop praying or stop teaching, but it calls it a matter of sin against God. Failure to exercise, and this does not only refer to the issue of praying, but failure to do the things that God requires of us as equal to sin. Failure of a husband to take care of his family is equal to sin. Failure of a woman to honor her duties as a married woman towards her husband, it is sin against God. You know, it's like people say, well, I feel like doing it, I don't feel like doing. The sin of omission, the things that we do not do, okay, they're equally sins as compared to the things that we do wrong. So you realize that it is important that we are aware that we must not sin against God in failing to do the things that are required of us. Whatever you know, is just like the Bible teaches us that we must show piety at home. So children are required to do certain duties at home. Failure of children to do duties at home is equal to sinning against God. Failure to serve in your team, failure to serve in your department, failure to serve in the areas you've been called upon to do. That's why Mordecai told Esther, you know, if you do not do this, then understand that deliverance and enlargement would arise from somewhere else, but you and your father's house shall be destroyed. It's not that, I mean, you know, look at it and see, but no. It says categorically, you shall be destroyed. And so here Samuel says that God forbid that I should sin against the Lord in season to pray for you. We must be duty-minded beyond our emotions, duty-minded beyond what we feel. So the Bible says, the one who knows what to do and does not do it, to him it is sin. So you know that you are to do right and you do not do it, it is equal to sinning against God. And you are not allowed to mess up and then expect a blessing from God. So we read from James 4 and verse 17. It says, therefore, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. You know what you're supposed to do and you don't do it. The Bible says it is sin. So it's not like, well, if I feel like, you know, I mean, I know what I'm supposed to do and I'll do it when I'm supposed to do it. That is not the way it works out before God. And it is important that you understand this morning, because you would face God one day. I would face God one day. You know, so whether or not I feel hot, whether or not I feel offended, I am required to do the things that I should do. This is where Paul will speak of necessity is laid upon him. You know, it is not like, well, okay, it's my volition, so I choose what to do. No, necessity is laid upon him. And I want us to know that necessity is laid upon us to do many things that we think we can do because we feel like doing it. That is not the case. We would give account. So let's look at 1 Corinthians 9 and verse 16. It says, for though I preach the gospel, I have nothing to glory of, for necessity is laid upon me, and woe is unto me if I preach not the gospel. For if I do this thing willingly, I have a reward. But if against my will, a dispensation is committed unto me. So we have got to get to the place where we get ourselves excited in doing the things that we are called to do, the things that are required of us. Because if you fail to do what is right, it is sin. It is a punishable sin. And you cannot afford to be sinned against God and expect God to bless you and expect eternity with God. We must be duty-minded. So Samuel took a posture of responsibility and committed himself, God forbid that I should sin against him. How? In doing what? In not praying for you. God forbid. We must be able to say this like Samuel. You know, when someone says God forbid, the thing is like, not just like, okay, well, I'll see. No. It is a posture that's been taken that I am not going to allow this in my life. God forbid that I should sin against him. I should sin against the Lord in not praying for you. Now, so two responsibilities given in this verse, and is that the first one is that of praying for people. The call to intercession is not just a call to priests. I know we have had intercessory groups all the while, but the call to pray for those in authority, the call to pray for the peace of a nation, the call to pray for your family has been laid squarely upon every child of God. And we must honor that duty. Otherwise, it is sin. This is how a lot of people sin in our ministry. Mondays are our prayer day. This is how you have multitudes in church on Sunday. But come Monday, you cannot see them. You cannot see them because you realize that they are not aware that this is sin against God. So you pray the whole of Sunday, you receive all the prophecies, all the declarations upon your life, and on some Monday, come Monday, you negate them. God does not hear the prayer of sinners. You close the door, but you refuse out to pray. But you refuse out to seek the face of the Lord. A time of prayer, you are sleeping. I mean, giving all your reasons why you cannot join in the prayers overnight. And you pray casually. Samuel realized that prayer was a ministry given to him. And in the New Testament, we should all realize it's a ministry given to all of us. Christ tells us men ought always to pray. In Luke 18 verse 1, you got to pray, you ought to pray. It's not you're encouraged to pray, you ought to pray. We're told to pray without ceasing. Let's look at the book of 1 Timothy 2 verse 1. And 1-4. I exhort therefore that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercession, and giving of thanks be made for all men and for kings and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. Everybody read the scriptures. I go again from verse 1. I exhort therefore that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. So you find out here that clear prayer points are delivered unto us as to what God requires of us. Intercession be made for all men, for kings, and for those that are in authority. So you find out that this is something given to every believer. That was not written to, you know, ministers of the gospel. It is a duty of every believer. In the book of Romans 5, verse 17, it says, pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. In First Thessalonians 5, verse 17, we must pray without ceasing. When Paul was speaking to the same Thessalonians, in 1 Thessalonians 2 verse 13, he says, for this cause also we thank God without ceasing. We are supposed to live a continual life of prayer, all right? And we must not sin against God in not praying for our land, in not praying for our president, in not praying for our pastors, in not praying for our family. If you are not a man and a woman who prays for your family, you are sinning against God. And that is a punishable offense. So lift up your hand and say, Father. Say it from your heart. Say loud, everyone. Say, Father, I accept the responsibility of praying for your flock, of praying for your people, in the name of Jesus Christ. So this is a duty that belongs to all saints. Let's look at the book of James 5, verse 16. Confess your faults one to another and pray for one another that you may be healed. That you may be healed. It's giving us what to pray for and what must be the outcome of a prayer. That you may be healed. And then look at the end of the verse. The effectual, fervent prayer of an anointed man, the effectual, fervent prayer of a prophet, the effectual, fervent prayer of a bishop, the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. So you find out that the effectual prayer, that word effectual means hot burning. Sincere prayer of a righteous man. It didn't say a man chosen as a pastor, but just a righteous man has tremendous power in his walking. So we are called to pray, every one of us. And if we fail to pray, we are sinning against God. Amen. The second thing that we see in this verse that Simon says, it is moreover, as for me, God forbid that I should sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray for you. But I would teach you the good and the right way. I would teach you the good and the right way. So we are called by God to admonish each other. We are called to teach each other. Our second responsibility is that every Christian is supposed to be a teacher who teaches the word. In 2 Chronicles chapter 15, verse 3, it says, now for a long season, Israel had been without the true God and without a teaching priest and without a law. So you find out that when once this was the case in Israel, many things went wrong because they were without a teaching priest. There were priests that could shout. There were priests that could talk. There were priests that could do many things. There were even priests that could pray, but left out the ministry, the teaching ministry. There are Christians who can pray, but cannot teach one another. In Romans 15 verse 14 it says, and I myself also am persuaded of you, my brethren, that you also are full of goodness, filled with all knowledge, and able also to admonish one another. So you see, you must be filled with knowledge. That is one of the reasons why you find out that we fail in this ministry to admonish one another, because we are not filled with knowledge. We must raise up congregation members that are full of goodness, full of the life of God, full of the nature of God. When we look at our members, can they be called upon, I mean, without notice, and called upon to come and stand on the pulpit and teach? Can we do that in the presence of visitors without being ashamed with what will come out of their mouths? You, as you're listening to this, can you stand? Can I just call upon you right now, impromptu, and I say, come, teach this session this morning. What will happen? Would you disappear? There are people that are called upon just to do one duty or another, and that is the end of it. You don't see them anymore. Me? No. You miss the person, Bishop. I can do other things. I can discuss politics. I can lecture on economics. I can, you know, speak anywhere else. I can discuss any matter. I can advise, give top advices. But when it comes to the teaching of the word, it's a different issue. And there's something Simon makes it known. Failure to do this, we are sinning against God. So you must know the good and the right way. He says here, I myself also am persuaded of you, my brethren. Persuaded of you, my brethren. I am convinced of you, my brethren. Not pastors, not ministers, that you are full of goodness and filled with all knowledge and able to admonish one another. The word admonish also means to bring to mind things that have been forgotten. Things that you once knew that you've turned your backs on. Or things that just need to be strengthened in. It's important though that when our members meet, our words, our communication is not full of all kinds of stuff. But we must build one another. Amen. We have been called to be kings and priests. And today God is calling on you and I to pray for his work. Amen. And to teach his word to others. I want you to take up that responsibility. God is calling on you this morning to take up that responsibility today. Amen. Lay aside the hearts. Pray for your church. Samuel was rejected. They turned their backs on him. They forgot all his labor. They forgot all his work. And when Samuel prayed, God answered and scattered the Philistines. We must not sin against God in not praying for people and not teaching them the word.
I believe you've been tremendously blessed by this program with such powerful exposition of God's word. Join the Living Word of Faith Outreach Ministries International in our next broadcast. Also join us in worship at the Faith Cathedral 5 and 7 Victoria Street in Freetown on Sundays at 7 and 9 a.m. and Thursdays at 6 p.m. For prayers, counseling and testimony, please call +232 30 90 007 or +232 77 853 207 or +232 77 858 1. This is the Living Word of Faith Outreach Ministries International.